Previously on the Project Umbrella podcast.
He must let the community know the truth. Gain his canon.
Generally didn't think that I would ever live to see this day.
You realise this will change everything about Project Umbrella.
Batman, come look at my pride and joy.
Find out about that reveal.
Whoa! What was that?
Any diarrhea, vomiting, itching, blur, vision, insomnia?
Lazy zombie.
You got me. Oh my God.
I don't know how long I've got.
Well, don't touch me, are you?
Project
Umbrella.
Hello and welcome to episode 22 of the Project Umbrella podcast. Still here after surviving the Bristol biohazard outbreak and hunting down George Trevor's dog to get that damn Gaiden information. I'm Nick, better known as Neptune, and joining me today is the Batman.
Hello.
Stars Tyrant.
Greetings and hello.
George Trevor.
Hello.
Mr. Spencer.
All right, dudes.
And our very special guest for this evening. It's a selfish gene.
Well-respected Resident Evil fan. Regular contributor to the Resident Evil community. With over 2,000 posts. Viewer of Degeneration in Japan. Well-known biohazard collector from Australia, it's the Selfish Gene.
Hello, everyone.
Welcome back, Selfish Gene. It's been a long time.
It has been a long time, but yeah, looking forward to talking about Outbreak 2.
Yes, yes, that's going to be the main focal point of our podcast.
Sorry, have I? Usually introduce the day.
No, that's fine, that's fine. So that's going to be the main focal point of our podcast. We're also going to be going through the news, site news, and we're going to have a quick chat about episode 21, which I hope you've all downloaded and watched on YouTube, and hopefully it hasn't pissed off too many people. We'll have a quick chat about that so we can explain how and why we did it. And then, of course, once we've gone through the Outbreak File 2 information and our comments on it, we'll finish off with this week's Neptune and Newsy's Biohazard quiz and a chance for you, Selfish Gene, to improve on your last score, which was a solitary 1 point.
I hope to, but I'm actually really worried that I'm going to embarrass myself again.
Well, let's see. But we'll start off by looking at all the latest news. First bit of news comes from our friends at IGN, that global mega website of computer games, where they managed to secure an interview with Shinji Mikami, someone who we'd like to secure an interview with, but hey-ho. And he claims that Biohazard 4 New Focus was down to the poor sales of Remake. Well, if you are going to put it on one console, then I don't quite know what he was expecting. But does anyone have any views on that?
I don't remember the sales being particularly bad. I thought it shifted quite a lot of GameCubes. It's certainly the reason why I bought one.
Yes, yeah, I bought one for it. So I don't quite know what Mickey. As I said, I'm not quite sure what they were expecting. They're never going to get PlayStation numbers. You know what they got for Code Veronica or anything.
Go on, mate.
Is he like the Noel Gallagher of video games? Like he just says, "Oh, we're bigger than Jesus. We're bigger than the Beatles," and people run the headline. Is that what he's up to?
Probably.
He basically said, didn't he? He told the team for the first three games that the objective was to scare the shit out of the player. But with the fourth one, the objective was to entertain the player.
And it's strange. I mean, we've talked about it quite a lot over the many podcasts, how at the time, I think a lot of Resident Evil fans were outraged by it. Although I think everyone enjoyed it. So I think he achieved in that objective. But time's been quite kind to Resident Evil 4, in my opinion.
Well, I will say, obviously, I've done a series playthrough, played all the games in order, and by the time you get round to Biohazard 4, the change is needed. It does feel so refreshing to play, because you get to that point and you just think, I can't be arsed with another T-virus outbreak and fixed cameras. You want a change.
But I found the story absolutely woeful.
It was at the time, but it's a lot more relevant now, thanks to subsequent games and material.
Yeah, well, we've trodden on those grounds many, many a time. Other news comes in the form of Biohazard 7. It's in the works, people. It's in the works. Apparently since November 2012. Yeah, yes. Newsbot tells us that that's quite common in games development to start it pretty much the month after the release of the last big title. Following on from that, we had Karen...
I was going to say, are you actually going to announce that as being confirmed?
Well, it might not be in development. They might just be doing pre-production because she was just a costume designer, wasn't she?
Yes, this was Karen Brackenridge. As she put on her LinkedIn page that she was doing, that, as you said, costume design.
There's just been a great silence since that news story broke. So.
But there was a similar thing with 6, wasn't there? There was a leaked voice actor.
Playing a Chinese zombie.
Yeah, and then it went quiet for a few months, didn't it?
So, Umbrella Chronicles had that happen too.
Yeah, but the studio she works for, that House of Moves, that's the same mocap studio they've used for 5 and 6. So it's probably true.
People, every time a new one is released, everyone's like, you put it to like a cycle now, can't you? It's like, new game released, everyone's really hyped, new game is shit, everyone's depressed, new game announced, everyone's like, oh, it's going to be great, you know, fantastic, new game to release, it's shit, and it's a cycle. Yeah, everyone's saying, oh, it'd be really good, 6 looks really good. People said the same about 6, though.
Yeah, but
no, I never said that about 6. It looked to
no,
me
no,
like
you didn't, but a lot of people did.
But wasn't 6 the first one really that was actually quite shit? You know, 4 and 5 were quite good. 4 especially was
I liked
brilliant.
5. 5
and, you
was
know, 5 was still
5.
A good guess.
5 was a bit rubbish for me. I didn't like it very much.
Piss off. 5 was way better than 4.
Yeah, I mean it kind of depends what you're talking about, because I mean I'm with John in terms of his opinion of the story in 5, particularly how it brings, you know, all the files together and the history of Progenitor. Mm-hmm. And I thought that the actual environment for the Sunflower, Stairway to the Sunflower was incredible, one of the best environments in Resident Evil. But then, you know, the gameplay that comes with that, it, for me, is just not Resident Evil at all. So that's particularly what I disliked about, you know, the past games. But my most recent ones, I mean, in terms of actual survival horror gameplay, you know, we would have to go back before Resident Evil 4.
Other news, this is your area of expertise, Batman and George Trevor. Volume 5, of Mahara Desire has been released in Japan. This feels it's gone on for quite a long time, Mahara Desire, considering it was supposed to be a prequel to RE6. We are now 1 year after release. But never mind. So that also comes with a special epilogue chapter showing old Ricky Twaza in Langsheng during the events
wait,
of...
Great pronunciation.
Just, I don't know.
Ricky!
Yes. During the events of Biohazard 6, watching and...
Your pillock.
Taking photos of Chris. Brilliant. So that's the big reveal that we're all waiting for what, 12
couldn't they have put...
18 months?
Couldn't they have put him as the cameo, as the camera guy that Chris shoves out of the way?
That
would have been so hard.
But it's interesting because, if I remember correctly, he's got immunity, hasn't he, to the C virus?
Yep.
And they just kind of don't dwell on him and just focus on Jake, you know.
Turns out he's Jake's brother.
So how canon are you treating that then?
It's canon.
It's canon as prelude.
It's written by the one of the scenario writers for 6.
I like how there's a rustling of paper, like John's looking at his notes. Yes. Like, yeah, it's the paper rustling around. Like,
no,
yeah,
I'm looking at the I'm looking at the credits here. I've got the fourth volume in French.
In terms of it being canon, how comfortable those that know a lot more about the virus mechanics than I do and the biology of the mutations, how comfortable are you with Bindi Bhagara, who's as lucid and articulate in her BOW form as she was before she mutated? I mean, she has normal conversations. I mean, she's almost like, I suppose she's in the same, she appears in the same state as Krauser when his arm mutates, and he's still having quite am I right? He just has quite a normal conversation with, he can speak normally to Leon. And
well, that's just his arm that mutated, wasn't it? Wasn't anything else.
I think the Juavo can talk. They're just like Ganados, really.
Couldn't Salazar talk to you as you fought him?
Yeah, he could.
Yeah, it's a thing that's happening in the series generally, you know, and Sergei as well. You have a monologue with him, don't you?
Yeah, it's written by Horishi Yamashita. Who is the Biohazard 6 game designer and scenario writer.
You know, the surname there should give you an indication as to what kind of quality you should be expecting.
Well, at least it was better than the Resident Evil 5 comics.
Oh my god, BOW's in
space.
BOW's in space.
You'd laugh about that, but I think that's a really good idea. Yeah, it was like Moonraker.
The problem with Mahawa Desire is, like someone mentioned it in one of the last podcasts we did, it should have been, the story they've told could have been done in 10 chapters rather than 39.
39.
That's the problem.
Well, George, the French version / volume 4's just been released. Are you getting that?
Well, I actually have it, and I
they've got it. Oh.
I gave it to a lady who works in Tesco's yesterday, who's French, and because I can translate it, but I have to rely about 40% of it. I have to rely on Google Translate, and the rest I can translate myself. But she's a natural French speaker, speaks perfect English, so I just gave it to her and just said, you know, how much do you want to translate this, love? You know, she works in Tesco's. I'm going up to Tesco to get her quote.
So well, that's dedication, that is.
That is, yeah. That's the scope of my research.
What can you say? But every little helps. So.
Well done.
It'd be on the next advert, won't it? Translating your biohazard material.
Tesco, the official sponsor, official translators of Project Umbrella.
Get the logo on the website.
Yeah, that'll go down well.
I mean, that's good to do, like, they do insurance, car insurance, petrol, and mortgages,
credit cards,
no, they're in translations.
Log on the forum 60 times to get 2p off a litre of petrol.
Oh, very good, very good.
Is that like, do you have like nectar points or something? Like, what's their point system called?
A club card. Yeah, I'll ask. Yeah, maybe I'll see if I can scan my club card to get money for the translation.
Like 10 pence off your next translation.
Yeah. Oh, right, so we are slightly detracting from the G's, but never mind. To celebrate the fact that Resident Evil 6 is now a year old, believe it or not, ResidentEvil.net has several free gifts for you to download. How exciting. 180,000 free points. Three extra tickets to unlock the RE1 and RE2 blocky polygon costumes if you really feel the urge. Some RE6 wallpapers and some extra files which has been taken from the archives book.
The extra files don't really have anything new in. Just the odd tidbit from the Club 96 thing.
Mm. I think that's generally quite a disappointing thing, wasn't it? That everyone was, oh, there's going to be extra files online, you know, so bit of social media involved. And then they, well, you know, it's just...
The best thing they could have done for the fans was actually put the full complete files in the game.
Yes, exactly. Exactly, but what can you do? That concludes all the Resident Evil news. Let's move on to the site news. We'll start off with some interesting site news. I hope everyone did enjoy episode 21, which was our Biohazard Gaiden podcast / vidcast.
When you say the word enjoy, I suppose it depends how you interpret the word cunt.
By enjoy, he meant fucking hated.
Yes, so a lot of work actually went into this. In terms of background, basically, we all, after doing nearly, 2 years' worth of podcasts, we decided, hey-ho, most of us live in the UK somewhere. Why not let's all meet up and, you know, just have a beer and chill out? And then, of course, the natural progression on that was if we are do a podcast or something like that. And then Batman pointed out, have you ever seen 2.8 hours later? I urge you to Google it all if you haven't. And basically, this company runs a kind of like zombie apocalypse day scattered all over the country, quite popular in London as well, where they have volunteer zombies be trained up by a professional chap, dancer slash zombie. And you just go around in groups of about eight to ten through parts of the city that's been cordoned off by the police, and it's just basically a game of tag, and the idea is to survive as long as humanly possible, trying to get to the asylum, which in this case was a zombie disco. And yeah, the idea was not to get tagged, and if you did, the zombie would grab you and put a little pen on your finger. So when we saw that, we decided, well, that'd be quite a good idea, why don't we film that for the podcast? And then that just kind of merged and morphed into an idea of, well, why don't we make it seem that everything's okay and we've got caught up in a zombie apocalypse, a bit like 28 Days Later, that'll be funny. And then basically a story kind of evolved involving Gaydon. We put the foundations down quite a long time ago in some podcasts, if you listen back to some old ones saying, oh, we're going to do a live podcast and whatnot. And yeah, it was good. And a big thank you has to go to our friend Jason. He's a next-door neighbour of George, and he's the chap that filmed all of it and edited it as well, and put in the wonderful CGI of the explosion from near George's old school. And that was...
That's my acting. That was just a...
Oh, was it? That wasn't...
Oh, that was just me. That was just improvised.
I think, to be fair, George, we're all blown away by your acting. It was sensational.
Oh, yeah.
There was something almost...
The explosion. That was just me improvising, though.
When you talk about RE4, there was something almost sort of David Brent-like in your delivery when you were like, it's like, wasn't it meant to like make RE4 canon or whatever? And you're like, not anymore. Not anymore. It's sort of David Brent almost coming through there, you know, like sort of like... Yeah, you should be able to, like, when he's talking about postage stamps and that you can use them as legal tender, and he's like, well, you should be able to pay for a taxi home with enough postage stamps, and he's like, shouldn't have to.
Did you like my sympathetic response to finding out that one of my closest friends was infected? So I recoiled in horror. Don't touch me.
Don't touch me, filth.
But yeah. Like the guy from RoboCop, you know, In the scene RoboCop where one of the guys gets covered in toxic waste, he's like a mutant and he's walking around the place and he sort of bumps into one of his mates, and this guy's like, whoa, don't touch me, man, and he runs away from him. That's what it reminded me of, you know, was that scene.
it was a bit of fun, and perhaps we did go a bit over the top on the build up on the forum, saying we've got big news incoming with Gaydon.
I mean, that was very much your idea, wasn't it, Nick?
No. But, you know, it was, you know, we wanted to, rather than just go, here's episode 21, enjoy, why not lure people into a false sense of security? And why not? It was a bit of fun. And, you know, people have forgotten about it now.
All I want to say is it took me 20 minutes to find a way to hang that shotgun on the wall, and no one's mentioned it at all.
Yeah.
You did struggle, yeah. And no one saw that we painstakingly manoeuvred the pool balls to be like the remake puzzle.
We did. That's exactly. It's exactly the same as the remake pool table. Just as I'm about to.
You know, this is like playing a point-and-click adventure game where you've got to look at all the different pieces in the area, or little details in the area, and you go like, "Oh."
There's lots of things to enjoy there. You know, we saw all of George's quite impressive collection, actually, wasn't it? It was, we've got a lot of stuff there, and the Monopoly board was there for you as well, if anyone wants it.
But at the end of the day, it's a pointless video. Don't watch it. Lame fuckers.
But it's had 200 separate views on YouTube.
Is it? Oh, that's not bad.
Yeah.
But I'm confused, Nick. Where was the Gaiden information?
Who knows? Who knows?
Seriously, I mean, without wanting to rub salt into the wounds, John, me and Nick were chatting, and whilst we were talking, just as it all broke, I had at least three separate people say to me, yes, okay, we get the joke, funny heart, but that's a pretty lame way to, pretty lame excuse to keep the information to yourselves. You know, now that you've taken us, at the very least, can't you still let us have the information?
What information?
You know who you are.
We had an email, which was just our tickets to get into this event, and just a copy of the of Biohazard Gaiden cartridge being patrolled by your dog. There is nothing else.
If we had Gaiden information, we'd release it legitimately. Of course we would.
Yes.
But we don't. We don't have any.
Or do we?
No.
I can't believe you guys have duped me this hard.
Oh, the best one is though, Sean. We had someone say, so you're telling me this is all a joke? You said Star's Tyrant lied to you, went to Bristol to do the podcast in good faith, only to find out that Star's Tyrant had made his colossal lie up. No, that was not what happened. Unfortunately, Star's Tyrant couldn't make it. He would have done, wouldn't you, Ty?
Yes, and I hope to be there for the next vidcast.
Yes, but so we thought we'd try and get him involved as best we can. So we thought we'd do that Skype call. Same with John as well.
You should point out, you know, Newsbot, who I don't think was overly enthusiastic about the project, did, you know, he kept a dignified silence about the whole situation.
Yes, and he has to be praised for bringing Samuel Jackson into the form. You know, that's just quite.
I think the next vidcast we do should be about, we have information that confirms the canonicity of the confidential reports. And see how many people get interested in that.
Zero. Approximately zero. Right, that will do. We're dwelling on our vidcast far, far, far too long. Hope everyone enjoys it. But we do have some other site news. Director's Hazard is now in English, thanks to the collective efforts of Project Umbrella. It's available on Project Umbrella TV and shows four directors, all pissed, talking about their games. Worth a view. Special thanks goes to the Batman, obviously, George Trevor, Robin over at Biohaze, Biohazard FE over at The Horror Is Alive, Greco at The Horror Is Alive, Okeji Dragon at The Horror Is Alive, and Romby, who's been on this podcast a few times.
Well, who are these two people here at the bottom? Six comments and one new comment. Who are they?
Yes, thanks. Brilliant, yes, thanks.
Oh, and Ridley's translated it into Spanish.
I see. Oh, there we go. For all you Spanish people out there, you're probably on another website anyway, but there you go, just in case you do come over here. We are also in the process of translating the Ada drama album that's been around for quite a long time now, because it was written back in just after RE2 came out, if I remember correctly. That's the Female Spy Lives drama album. That should be uploaded by Halloween.
Is that by Flagship?
Batman.
Oh, come on, Nick. Come on, Nick.
Show this.
Something got a vendetta against you, Nick.
Come on, Nick. This is your baby.
Yeah, but it's not canon. Because it totally is. I don't know. Yes, it's by Flagship, but it's been totally contradicted.
Well, neither is your Resident Evil Monopoly, but you still see that as your baby and look after it.
What, why is this my? Why is Ada, the Female Spy Lives, my baby? I've got nothing to do with it.
It's your news. It's your news. You're the.
Oh, right.
You're the host. Yeah, it was written by Flagship.
Yes, that's right.
Well done.
Thanks. Oh, blimey! Pushing me out, guys. Pushing me out. Final bit of site news. I hope everyone's been following the series playthrough that's been undertaken by Batman and Star's Tyrant and George Trevor to an extent as well. You've done it.
Oh, well, I've only temporarily dropped out. I'm up to Dead Aim and I'm just writing an article. And after Halloween, I'll be back onto that, starting at Dead Aim. I'm really looking forward to that one.
Stars, you've pretty much finished, haven't you? A few more chapters to go in RE6?
Three chapters of six left. And yeah, it's been really good too. It's been the first time I've done a chronological playthrough in about 13 years. So obviously the series has expanded a lot since then. I've really enjoyed it. And I've not really had any series fatigue kick in. In fact, brace yourselves. I've really enjoyed Biohazard 6's story. I really have. I think when you play it chronologically, I think it really works. And it's quite nice to see Carla go sort of in parallel to what Ada's doing. It almost works. It's not a bad game. It's just vehicle sections. What were they thinking?
Yeah.
There's some mistakes they made, but it's not the lowest point for me, honestly, has been, and I said this to Batman earlier, there's one game which really sticks out and doesn't really fit in when you play through it chronologically, and that is Revelations. It just, it doesn't seem to just, I don't know what it is about that game which just doesn't stick, but I don't know whether it's all the politics that's at play, but the characters don't really feel like themselves, and I think there's just too much in it to really make it a relevant title, because by the time you get to the next title, it's all completely forgotten. And, you know, unless that game gets a direct sequel, I can't really see the point of why it's in the series at all. I just can't. And, you know, it's just funny that Terra Grigia is arguably just as bad a catastrophe as Raccoon City, yet no one ever talks about it, ever.
I know why, because it's not in America, it's in Europe. No one gives a fuck. Why would they?
But yeah, Revelations is the one that stuck out to me as just being... It's pretty worth a century, actually, unfortunately.
Would you say that Resident Evil 6, internally, if you like, the actual story within the game is quite enjoyable, but it's when you compare it and put it into context, it kind of falls down
I think if it was a CG movie, I think people would really enjoy it.
I think it's
the fact that the gameplay is fun, and I like the controls, and I like the sliding, and the combat's all pretty decent, but it's just... a myriad of ideas which don't really gel together. It's like, you know, it's just a bit of a mess. That's the problem with it. It's just a mess.
And Batman, you've just watched Damnation, I believe.
Well, I've started 6, and I quite enjoy the Adonia parts and the Tall Oaks parts, but once you get to China, it starts to drag a little bit. And I actually think 6 has the worst story of the lot. But I think a lot of it's camouflage, because we have got 7 characters and series veterans, you know, in the same game for the same time, and you know, there's a lot of movie style cutscenes, and it's all a bit camouflage, but at its core the story is just shite.
Yeah, it's still ultimately about nothing, and that's and they did destroy a great villain in Simmons.
And what's weird is I've always praised Resident Evil 5, but that game is actually the one I've enjoyed the least on the series playthrough.
Wow.
I enjoyed it up until 4. I really enjoyed 4, and then after that, the story just becomes fractured, and it's just a series of one-off adventures. And
I think we feel the same about 5. I mean, we've always had a similar opinion about 5, but what the series playthrough really struck to me is that the story in that game does not become relevant until Chapter 5, when we start exploring an Umbrella lab. Wesker's not in the game until Chapter 5-3, really. Yeah. He's not formally introduced to Chris, and then it's literally over within sort of half an hour after that, you know, so all the really big important stuff happens in the 11th hour of the game, which means you've just got hours of filler and pointlessness before it.
I hate the going through the marshlands and the tribal villages. It's just pointless. It's not what you've waited 4 years to play. I think 5's got the best story of the series, but the problem is it's all in the background files. Mm. It's not in the game itself, which is annoying.
All right, well, I think that concludes all our news. And with that, we can now move on to our main discussion of the evening, Resident Evil Outbreak File 2.
Thank you.
So, moving on to File 2, this is a follow-up to the somewhat successful, it went platinum in the UK at least, Resident Evil Outbreak 1. Originally, obviously, it was part of a much, much bigger game with about 30 chapters, I think, was originally planned. Reduced down to another 5. What did everyone, brief impressions first, chaps, what did everyone think of the follow-up? Because there were some changes to the original Outbreak games in terms of features, load times, running and shooting, I think, was introduced in Outbreak 2. So what did everyone think? Mr. Spencer, what did you think?
It didn't really do much more for me than Outbreak. It was just like Outbreak, but a little bit more. You know, it was just more the same, really. It felt more like an expansion of an existing game as opposed to a new game in the series. You know, it's like, oh, you know.
Good or bad for you? I mean, you know, that may be a good thing, maybe a bad thing.
But... My problem with Outbreak File 2 is the same with the original Outbreak, is the fact that if only it had... It didn't really have the online architecture at the time to fully support it, to have it reach its full potential. If a game like Outbreak and File 2, you know, put them together here, right? If games like that were released with the online structure we have today with the PS3... I reckon it would have been a huge success. I reckon people would have liked it because it would have had faster loading times, it would have played a lot smoother, a lot quicker, it would be a lot easier to get into games, have a drop-in, drop-out mechanic, and there you go. What was Outbreak's undoing with File 2 and the original game, of course, and branching them together, is the online. It was just too fiddly, too difficult to get involved in that, and I think that's what did it in the end.
Okay, Selfish Gene, what do you think?
I've got rose-tinted glasses here for this for this podcast. So I'm going to say I really, really liked it. But at the same time, I probably couldn't play the game today because of just the long loading times and the horrible online with no communication and things like that. But playing it at the time, I really liked it. I really liked the first Outbreak. And it is more of the same, but it's a refinement in parts. Like, you know, you can walk and shoot and things like that. So I actually think it's the best example of the old mechanics with the fixed camera angles and the shooting and stuff, because, you know, the cameras kind of pan in parts to follow you, which really works well. You can walk and shoot, which, you know, well, it was in Dino Crisis, but it was never in Biohazard. I think it's the best use of those mechanics, but then of course they all got dropped when Resident Evil 4 came out, and we all know what happened there.
Star Siren?
I never played it online, but from a single-player point of view, I thought the scenario showed a lot of ambition and a lot of variety. But I thought nearly every good idea was met with an equally bad one, which we'll get into later. Nearly every scenario was ruined through a stupid, silly mechanic, which could have been avoided. It does house Desperate Times, which is the very scenario or chapter of the Biohazard timeline which actually inspired me to do my own. So, there we go.
Well, I can't say higher praise than that. Batman?
Pretty similar views, really. I quite liked it, but I never actually got the opportunity to play it online, which is something I've always regretted. But I think it does have its place in the series. But my main drive for buying it at the time was just for the files and the few story tidbits. You know, it would add to the Raccoon City story. Really.
Okay, and George Trevor?
Well, I think the fact that I've not played it should stop me from saying that it's a huge missed opportunity because we can't get to play it online. I didn't get to play it online. I've played it very briefly in build-up to this podcast, but it's this with Gun Survivor 2 are the two games I've really have hardly played at all. I suppose the reason for that is all the reasons for why I've not played much of Outbreak 1, the control system, the lack of the servers not being available anymore to play them online. To me, they don't particularly work well as games to play by oneself, you know, offline. For me, is like Batman, my only interest in them currently, in their current format, is just the tidbits and extra information on the series canon.
We'll move on and talk about the characters because, I mean, I'm not sure how long we want to dwell on the main 8 characters, because of course we probably did that quite a lot on the Outbreak discussion, and because it's all part of the same kind of storyline, and all the scenarios interlink with other scenarios in what particular order, whatnot. I don't quite know what we could really say about Kevin and Mark and George, that we didn't say previously. So I propose we just talk about the NPCs a bit more, because once again, there's quite a lot of non-playable characters in this, in these games. Did anyone stand out for you? Because
Marvin,
Return of Marvin, yes. Rita and Linda and whatnot, they were quite cool. But does anyone want to say anything about any of them?
There was no Greg Muller this time, was there? There was no legendary line of dialogue.
No, we did miss that.
It's only really Desperate Times which has a really good support cast, because even though End of the Road has a few colourful characters of the Biohazard mythos, like Arnold of the UBCS, they're all pretty forgettable, I must say.
I liked Arnold, he was pretty cool.
But he just disappears from the storyline. He's in that sort of one scene and then...
Yeah, because he predicted RE4 and knew where the series was going. Get the fuck out of there, just like Nikolai.
And is it Rodriguez, the USS?
Yeah, it's nice to see them back. You know, nice links. I was just, you're right, just having a quick think back in my mind.
Tommy Nielsen. Yeah, it's nice to see an Umbrella executive. Mm. You know, someone who isn't militaristic in any way whatsoever, and still knows how to operate a Stinger missile launch. Yeah, quite like.
It must be part of their, you know, induction week. Welcome to Umbrella. This is your HR manager. Now, this is how you operate a Stinger missile, just in case. Never mind. But
End of the Road is good for the expanded sort of universe you get in it. It's one of the first times you can see all these different divisions of Umbrella at play. And, you know, almost working against each other. And that's really good. The game should have gone more into that direction. I didn't really care much for Al and Dorothy in the flashback chapter.
Well, yes, that's true. We never see Dorothy, of course, do we? So, but I'm sure we'll probably talk about about that scenario in a bit more depth in a minute. But I was just trying to think, Underbelly didn't really introduce anyone, did it? It was all just boring subway workers.
You had the zoo staff at Wild Things. I think there was three or four of them still alive, wasn't there?
Yeah.
And that was another thing about the NPCs that we didn't get in the PAL version of the game, because they took the ad-libbing out. I know in the American version, you can have like text conversations with the NPCs, can't you? You can't do that in the PAL version of the game. Like, you know, Rita will have a conversation with Kevin in the police station. And things like that, but we don't get that.
Why would they do that? Remove them then? Just because it got? Because no, we could go online. We could play online Outbreak 2. If you had all the connections, Outbreak 2 in PAL, you could.
Could we edit that?
I'm sure we could.
No.
Was it Outbreak 1 that we could? No.
No, you couldn't in number one.
I think you can ad lib commands and that, but you can't have, like, I've seen videos of the American version where you have text conversations with the NPCs.
Yeah, I've got the American version, and it's the only time in the game you can actually find out Yoko's backstory when you ad lib Linda. Is it?
And what does she say?
Just explains about how she was experimented on and memory wiped. But the only reason I could think it was taken out would it be for European translations? You know, the cost factor of translating it all to French and Spanish.
Maybe, probably bloody French. Yeah, probably. Never mind. Okay, well, we can probably talk about more NPCs, but let's go through each of the scenarios. We'll start with Wild Things.
the citizens of Raccoon City. That looks like the city zoo's rear gate. If a rescue team's on the way, I'd better hurry. I have kind of a bad feeling about this, but it looks like I should check it out.
Certainly, I remember seeing, when we first saw the Raccoon City map that came out with Resident Evil 3, and the fact that it had a zoo, I always thought at that point, wouldn't it be quite exciting to go to the zoo, just to see what shit's caused there? And lo and behold, this game took us to the zoo. We also see the death of Cindy in that one. Or is
yes.
it Lisa? Cindy, yeah, Cindy gets brutally killed by old Titan, Oscar the Elephant. But I just start with what I think. I did think it was a slight disappointment, really. Because although there's a few animals, I never felt that it was as expansive or as absolutely fucked up as it should be. I mean, if there was a T-virus outbreak and the zoo is infected, I mean, you just wouldn't go there. You're asking for trouble. And you see things like the gorilla, don't you? He's dead on the floor. You never get to...
Yeah.
You're right, because it's sort of like, right, there's a T-virus outbreak. So what you see it's doing to any living being, like humans, it's really fucked them up and does terrible shit to organic life forms.
Mm.
So we're in a city, that's banned up as it is. Hey, you know where you should go, guys? The fucking zoo!
Yes.
There's loads of animals there, and this thing's fucked up.
If you watch the scenario intro, that's pretty much what they do. They just say, let's go through the zoo. And it's like, why are you doing that? Just stop it.
Yeah. And
yeah.
I mean, in terms of animals, you obviously get...
It makes no sense.
You get the elephant, you get the lion, hyenas, hornbills, alligator.
So you know, I really liked that they've, instead of using dogs, they've used the hyenas. And instead of the crows, they've got the hornbills. I really like that
they missed an opportunity
that detail there.
By what they should have done is given that the T-virus has an impact on, like, insects, for example, makes them bigger and more powerful and whatnot, like spiders and such, they should have gone for, like, the bug area of the zoo.
Yeah.
And that would have been interesting, because you imagine, like, giant sort of, well, not centipedes, but the insect world is creepy, right? Imagine giant versions of all those creepy little fuckers. Like, imagine this gene, then, a giant redback spider.
Mm.
Oh, fuck that.
There you go, exactly.
Come on, underbelly has a giant flea.
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you guys, actually. Because I think Zero's copped a lot of criticism for the BOWs in that. And yet all the animals in the zoo, they sit well with me. It's like, they're all fine. But all the monkeys are okay in Zero. But the insects in Zero, I look at them and just think, they're really shit. But what do you guys think about the BOWs in the zoo?
It's like, in zoo, it's all right. It makes sense because it's a fucking zoo. You go to Zero, where's this spider come from? Why is there a centipede knocking about down near that place?
Yeah. Scorpions on a train.
Yeah, what's the scorpion doing knocking on a train?
But they were quite sensible, weren't they, with the animals they chose? They didn't go overboard. You know, like you didn't want to see like zombie penguins running around.
That would be cool.
But I almost feel that, you know, you could make a whole game set at Raccoon City Zoo, couldn't you? If it was big enough. About the diversity of creatures that you'll come across would be enormous. Yeah, I don't know. Zombie penguins would be quite amusing. You have them sliding down on the ice, jumping out of you from the water. But yeah, I mean, the scenario itself, they kind of, you know, Oscar the elephant kind of takes on a nemesis type role, doesn't he? You don't quite know when he's going to come out, and then you kind of lure him into a little, you know, trapeze. Not trapeze.
To be honest, a bastard hard scenario.
It is. The respawning hornbills are pissing off.
No one played that scenario online. Like, no one. The other thing, yeah, so the scenario is really, really hard online. The other thing about it is once you've done the cafe part at the start, there's no zombies. And all
That's
the
true.
Monsters are really deadly. Like the lions, the lionesses rather, and the elephant can just come anytime and kill you.
Mm.
He can snatch you out of the office and kill you in one hit.
Which
is really kind of cruel.
As well.
The lions, if you can't shoot them, then you know you're in a lot of trouble. The hyenas are okay, but Yeah, really, really tough scenario, and I don't think I ever played it online because everyone just used to die too quick.
Just running from the elephant.
Yeah, I just bolted it. I thought the bit in the office was a bit quite Dino Crisis-y, wasn't it? With the
I liked it in the office because you felt kind of safe there.
House place with the fucking mosquitoes which fly around and all that. Yeah. Well, God,
well, let's be honest, the whole Outbreak 2 is littered with, I mean, there's certainly a plant theme going through a lot of the games, isn't there? You've got that Rastafella thing, which just so happened to bloom at exactly the same time and whatnot. And then obviously the other scenarios, you've got Dorothy, and then you've got the Nightshades are called, aren't they? Nightshades and what? And then the green zombies. So there's quite a lot of plants in this one.
Actually, I've got a bit of a problem here, right? Was Desperate Times in the final two, wasn't it?
Yeah,
Desperate Times?
One.
Can I just say, the fucking nerf gas canisters, they were annoyed the hell out of me. I was like, I just explore this place. Oh, wait a minute.
We'll get to that.
Well, it annoys me. I'll get into it now, because it annoys me so much. Why would you do that? Why would you have this in a game?
I don't know. That's fine. Does anyone want to say anything else about Wild Things?
The reason I like Wild Things is because it's completely non-linear. There's so many different ways you can go around it to get to the end.
That's true.
And obviously, if you change the difficulties, the keys get swapped around and the puzzles change and the locked doors change. There's a lot of replayability there.
The option of two different bosses for the scenario as well.
The only thing I don't like about it is the respawning monsters. I think that's a bit unfair because ammo is so scarce.
Yeah, the end boss, no matter which one you pick, is quite difficult. I think I remember the first time I did it, I did have the elephant, and that was literally down to the knifing his legs, and very hard. Sorry, Sean, you're going to say?
I was going to say on the series playthrough, I think I got Titan first and died horribly. And then I got the lion the second time, which I did on danger with a knife.
With a knife. Satisfaction, though.
No, it was awful.
Was it?
Because I just thought, you know, if I lose all this progress now, I've got to sit through this fucking scenario again.
All right, well, we'll move on to Underbelly. Just said about dying on danger. I remember leaving that area, an Underbelly, literally on zero health, and then climbing up that mega ladder right at the end, trying to escape. And that was so annoying because I was like, I'm not. And the timer was ticking down, or my health gauge or whatever it was, viral gauge was going up.
Have you never escaped properly?
No, I've only ever done.
The cooling tower is the ending I got this time. I've never done it before. This is a series playthrough. It was the first time I'd ever found it.
So,
and, you know, read the post back, because it's a description of how tense it was. I never thought the series could do that to me, because I actually finished it on something like 99.3 virus gauge. It was horrible.
And you're like, come on, climb! It's just hurry up. But overall, that was a shite scenario. And obviously Umbrella Chronicles used it, didn't they? All the backgrounds for it.
Mm-hmm.
But I found it very dull, obviously, than it's supposed to be, and a bit drab. And I didn't like the fleas. I really didn't like them. And the bouncing fleas. They're rolling down. What did anyone else want to have a... What did everyone's view on that one?
I actually liked the environment.
Did you? Okay.
Yeah, but I thought it'd be just kind of better to go through rather than, like, why are they trapped there, you know? Like, wouldn't you just run down the tunnel? Like, in Resident Evil 6, there's that bit in the train station. And I actually think that's really cool. Because, you know, you just go through it. Mm. Whereas, yeah, like the maintenance areas. Yeah, I thought it was... I actually quite liked the environment.
I question the need for a subway system in Raccoon City. But yeah, that's another issue aside. I mean,
doesn't it have a monorail?
Well, yeah, it's got the cable car from RE3.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah, the cable car is at the monorail, isn't it? So why would it need a...
Why would it need both?
Doesn't it actually say in the game that it goes to the next town or something? I'm pretty sure it does. It's been a long time, but...
To Stoneville?
Well, it's not really a long sort of... it's not really a big station, is it, really, at Raccoon?
No, it's only, there's like only four two platforms, isn't it?
I think one stop goes to Warren Station, doesn't it? Which
that's
the catalyst for the outbreak in the first game.
But I presume that's named after the mayor as well.
Yeah.
Which I quite like. I just like, there's a bit of detail in it as well, which I quite liked.
Now, this, is, of course, was Jim's scenario, and you had the benefit, if you chose to play as Jim, as having access to every room or every door, didn't you, if I remember correctly?
Yeah, Bats and I used Jim. The virus gauge is horrible for him.
Yeah.
If you use David, you can use his masking tape to fix the pipe. You don't have to find the roll of tape.
Oh, I always forget to do that.
Yeah, I know.
So you
can
just cut out a big part of the scenario if you pick David.
That's useful to know for anyone thinking of replaying it. But I mean, in terms of BOW, you got the megabytes, which are right pains up the arses anyway. I didn't find the gigabyte particularly difficult, but okay, you got the zombies. They're bugs down the bottom as well, aren't they?
It's just,
where's the ticks? There's ticks in it or something.
Ticks, yeah. It can cause annoying bleed statuses on you.
Yeah.
Really,
but are the guys that were like knocking about in that rubbish tip? That's like a room you go into.
Yeah, it's full of bugs.
In Umbrella, obviously, in Umbrella Chronicles, a bit updated graphics. It looked better in Umbrella Chronicles, but obviously that scenario was just not even worth mentioning. But
There's no particular story, is there? There's no NPCs. You just go in.
Try and
escape out the other end. Yeah.
Again, you know, it has a plus because it has two wildly different outcomes. But it's more of a chore than it is enjoyable to play.
Yeah, at least, of course, with Outbreak 2, one of the main differences is that you didn't have to play all of them in order. You could just start straight away and, you know, you could pick the M1. You didn't have to go through each scenario before unlocking.
You did have to unlock End of the Road, didn't
you? Yes, apart from that, yeah. So you had to play it at some point.
You could pick your partner characters as well, couldn't you?
That was useful, because then you could always pick... I mean, I think most people probably pick Yoko, didn't they, just for the extra space...
I was always Mark, because he was a very sort of robust character that just shoves zombies out of the way, and he started with a gun.
No, I was just saying, you choose
your
partners.
No.
Hell.
So, yeah, it was all right. I just found it very bland. Right?
Hey, Bob, where's your mind at?
George, do you have any views on this one?
I've not played it, no. I can make some up. Sorry.
You've played Umbrella Chronicles.
I've been keeping a dignified silence.
You've played Umbrella Chronicles, though?
Yes.
Yes, then the Raccoon's Destruction's underbelly. So you can have at least a comment on the environment.
Sorry, I went out to get a cup of tea. I missed what you were saying. Sorry.
I just said, obviously, if you haven't played Underbelly, you've played Umbrella Chronicles.
Yes.
And the Raccoon's Destruction, the retelling of Jill's and Carlos' story, that's using Underbelly. So you can comment on the environment at least.
Two in Raccoon's Destruction.
Yes.
I didn't realise those were repeated environments from Outbreak.
Yes, they were.
Yeah.
I didn't realise that. Sorry, all joking aside, I didn't know that. Okay. That's interesting because at the time of playing Chronicles, I wasn't aware of that. And they certainly didn't feel in any shape or form out of place. They felt very natural and very much contextually, within that environment. They worked very well.
Okay. We're flogging a dead horse here. We'll move on to Flash. Sorry. Move on to Flashback.
I've been called worse.
I don't get many visitors around here. I hear the city's in quite a state right about now. Well, there is an old road through these woods that leads to the neighboring town. It's easy to get lost, I'm afraid. Let me show you the way. Let's hope no one gets hurt. It's not like there's a decent hospital around here, after all.
Hospital?
Flashback. Now, I'm just going to plug our friend and yours, Chimera. Looking through my old emails, and back in 2009, I've still got the email, Chimera sent me a very lengthy email about Flashback and how it all linked in with everything, and lovely scenarios, which this was done just after Project Umbrella kind of launched, really, more than anything. But it's been a chapter that it feels so out of place, not necessarily because of the environments, just because it never felt easy with the people trapped in Raccoon City. I got that. And then to kind of leave Raccoon City, escape for all intents purposes. Yes, there's a bit of BOW action going on outside in the forest. But then to make the conscious decision to go back into the city.
The alternate endings highlight this quite well, or the additional ending.
Does it?
Because each character, if you get the final ending, has a little bit, and they all talk about how there's like army snipers in the forest that are shooting people on sight. And I think it Mark's ending, or it could be David's, mentioned how all roads just lead back to the city. So it's a cop out. The one with the army snipers is pretty good. That they actually have a quarantine zone in the forest. So there is no other choice other than just to go back and try and find another way.
Okay. I'll take that back then.
What did Chimera say in your correspondence?
I don't know, a long time ago.
You just said you had the email already.
I'll open it up.
You just mentioned it as a point of interest.
I'll open it up. Hold on, you guys chat amongst yourselves. I will.
Why should he even bother now? You can't even... Remember.
It was, I mean, certainly it was homage to Resident Evil 1, wasn't it? I thought it was, back in Arklay Mountains / Forest, and a creepy abandoned hospital, being chased around by Axeman. The email was to do with the timeline, because at that point we didn't have access to all the email, all the files, at least the translated ones, and I remember correctly now, they were all the timelines were all fucked up with, the dates of when everything was happening with Alan Erdott, because I'm sure the English one was all wrong with 1993 and it's long time ago, but that was very interesting. Back then.
It does have quite an extensive backstory, doesn't it? This scenario,
it's good.
And has it got the first mention of Chief Irons covering everything up?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's got a lovely. I do like some of the files where it goes intense appetite, which is quite nice. About Dorothy, which is quite...
Conceptually, it's a great little scenario. And if you play as Alyssa and you actually get the flashbacks, it is a very nice little self-contained story, which would have made a cracking game in its own right. But within Outbreak, it's just ruined by, once again, stupid mechanics. It is ridiculously hard. Every enemy can poison you pretty much. It's an absolute nightmare to play, but story-wise, you can get a lot from it. It's good, and the files reward you a lot if you actually stick around and read them all. And yeah, it's amazing from a timeline point of view how early some of these events are, with them being dated like in 1993, and it's a few years before it all went to hell.
And we also have the new T-virus, a new variant of it that can help cure cancer. Which I think at the time was quite, really? But that kind of idea was taken on a bit with Dark Side Chronicles.
Yeah, I was going to say.
And, and some of the actual benefits of the virus. It was a slightly different strain. And, I think it was handled quite well, as you said. But I said that, 1993, Dorothy was infected. So it's a long time before we see the, you know, the results of Dorothy in the plant thing. Axeman was interesting because he's one of the frequent ones that we talk about when dealing with rare and odd mutations of the T-virus. He's obviously bonded quite well with the T-virus, in many ways better than perhaps some of the tyrants. He's able to maintain his independent free will, but pretty much indestructible.
Doesn't he go from L to the X-Man back to L? Like, can he? I always kind of assumed he wasn't even infected because he's just so normal.
He just has a strange growth on him, doesn't he?
But so, yeah, he, obviously when you meet him in the wooden hut, you know, he's just, for all intents and purposes, he's normal. But then obviously by the time you get to the hospital, he's chasing you around and he's got a green thing, isn't he, on his chest.
Mm.
And that's what... But yeah, well, I'm guessing he can obviously go back to Al because...
I think he's always Al. I just think he's been chopping people up to feed for Dorothy. That's all he's doing.
What, do you think he can mutate from his grey skin back to white skin?
Well, I just think he's... Well, I don't think this... I think the skin thing is maybe going a bit too far. I don't think it was ever meant to... I think he is always Al and he's very... he's always aware of what he's doing.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
his face
yeah.
doesn't really change.
Oh, yeah, if you wanted to talk to Axeman, you probably could. But
I think all he does is literally put a sack on his head and then just start chopping people up.
Yeah, but that's a very unique reaction to the T-virus.
Oh, it is, yeah.
No one else, not even tyrants, quite have that ability, you know, that self-awareness, if you like, of who they are and what they're doing. And just one of those unique ones to add to Hilda in Darkseid Chronicles. Very unique.
Dorothy's actually a playable NPC, like skin unlock.
Is she? Oh, wow. Well,
yeah, I'm just looking through the catalogue of them all now. Yeah, she's there.
What's she look like?
She's kind of... Well, don't you see her in the cinematic once you kill the plant? Doesn't she kind of squirt out the front of it?
Yeah, she does. Yeah. And then a big rock.
But yeah, she's got she's got an in-game model. Yeah, she's like just wearing a nightie. Like, she's a zombie by the looks of it. Yeah.
It was the plants on the roof are a pain up the arse, though, weren't they? The nightshades. Mm. They constantly got you. Constantly got you. I can't remember. Is there eternal blue herbs like there is in Code Veronica?
I don't know. Maybe not.
No, I don't think. I couldn't find one, I don't think. It was awful.
Yeah. And, of course, we've got the green zombies, which is a nice variation of the zombies. They're a bit tougher, I thought. And
you couldn't shoot them. You couldn't do anything with them.
They're just annoying.
If you hit them, they sprout, you know, squirted out a load of poisonous
gas. Yes, they did. Yeah. And then you also, I think you said in a previous podcast, Ty, that in different modes you had the scissor tails instead.
Yeah, you do. On hard and very hard.
So, I don't know, generally, what did everyone think of Flashback? Good, bad, indifferent?
Indifferent.
It's indifferent. Another indifferent.
Yeah, I'm pretty indifferent.
I love the concept. I love the setting. And I just utterly hate the gameplay on it. I really do.
It doesn't feel very Resident Evil. Like,
it's quite linear, to me, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Obviously. But just like a little story of, you know, creepy guy in the woods. It's like, you know, a sit around the campfire sort of story rather than bioweapons. I don't know. It's okay.
The Axeman concept was weird. What's the T-virus done to him? Just made him invulnerable to gunfire.
Yeah. As you said, it's odd, isn't it?
Mm.
Okay, we'll move on to the two biggies at the end then. Desperate Times.
Take a look at this. It's a map of this place back when it was an art museum. There should be a ventilation tunnel in the ground.
And that'll get us out of here?
It should, but it's so narrow you might be the only one who can fit through.
So I'll get help and come back, right? Looks like it's a race against time.
Now that we've lost communications, there's nothing else we can do. All right, everyone. We've got to hurry up and find a way into that tunnel. It's going to be our way out of here.
Desperate Times. That was brilliant because we got to go back to the RPD. Although it did mess up with the geography of it again.
Not too much. Only one room.
Down in the garage.
Oh, well, yeah, some cars are in a different place, but mainly it's the waiting room on the second floor.
Yeah.
I don't mind the odd placement of cars being different too much.
Oh, No, it wasn't that. It was the secret crumbs. What was it? Was it the crawl part that where he crawled out from?
Yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, where you can go from the...
outside.
It's from the garage to the underpass.
Yes, that was...
the front door, yeah.
That was...
And that's...
It's a gameplay linking device, isn't it?
But I think that vent was always in Biohazard 2 background. I think it was.
Maybe.
There was no, you could never go through a grilling.
No, you couldn't go through it, but it was always there.
I'll have a check.
Have a check for us, and then yeah. So anyway, that's a minor point. Overall, though, I mean, I thought this scenario was actually quite cool, and I love the fact that there was an item box that you could stand on upstairs. That was awesome. But what was everyone's view going back to the RPD again?
I love this scenario. They get everything about it right. The look, the music, absolutely everything about it is perfect. The NPCs, and they fucking ruin it all with the nerve gas mechanic. I can't believe how, you know, a game designer can comfortably have the ball in their hand and just drop it so spectacularly as they did. It actually makes it quite unplayable at times, because all you want to do is explore these, yep, you know, wonderful environments recreated, and every time you just getting a feeling of it, and you know, you're walking around and you're examining things, the fucking alarm goes off, and the room fills with gas, and you check your inventory and you've not got the item you need, and you have to leave the room, and it's just, oh, it's awful.
It was down in the bottom levels, wasn't it?
It was everywhere. That's right. Except the main hall. Every room could do it except the main hall.
Oh, perhaps I was fortunate enough only to ever have it. I always seemed when you went downstairs to the kennels. Oh, bummer. I only done it once. It was a pain up the arse.
Biohazard 2 things as well.
It was, and it wasn't. It was a thing put in by Irons, wasn't it? I'm sure I remember reading a file.
Yeah, he does it. It's the same reason he disperses the ammo around the station. You know, the suppliers, because there's been a terrorism threat. So.
Oh.
Yeah, I really liked that they said it was an art museum in the intro when Marvin's going through the plan and he shows the map and they said there's the tunnel from when it used to be an art museum. I just thought that was a really, really cool thing to do, because up until that point, everyone was just saying, oh, you know, it's so unrealistic, it was a police station and everything like that. But
it was.
Yeah,
I said,
that was cool.
I think the way they used Marvin, as we said, was very good, and it's nice.
You know, everything about it other than the nerve gas, it, you know, make no mistake, without the nerve gas, it was a hot contender for best scenario of them all. It, you know, it's brilliant.
There's no way to turn it off, is there?
No. You put a cheat code and disable the virus gauge. That's the only way you could get around it. Because all it affects is the virus gauge, you see. It just causes the virus gauge to shoot up. It doesn't actually hurt you in any way.
I remember seeing screenshots before the game came out that they'd rendered the RPD in 3D, and I lost my mind. I was so excited for the game.
And they do it so lovingly, you know. They even have a touch of the remake bug in them, because they actually did totally redesign the corridor that you go underground in, where the Watchman's room is. They put a load of deer heads up and everything. It looks amazing, and you just, for a minute, you think, actually, I don't think I'd mind a remake of Breath 2 or Bio 2, because it, you know, would actually look great. I hope they never do.
No.
I love the game as it is, but you know, just for that corridor, they almost give you a taste of what it would be like.
There's lots of nice little references as well. Like if you actually examine that deer head, it says something like "donated by Mr. B. Irons."
Oh wow! I've never even tried that.
Lovely little things like that.
I think Kevin gets some extra background flavor as well, because you know he works there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you go through and play as Kevin, you can pick up on things more.
He can unlock his personal locker in the Watchman's room.
Yeah, that's right.
He can unlock, is it Officer, what's his name? Is it Gene? He can unlock his desk in the Eastern office, because you get the cord off his body, don't you, in Underbelly.
Oh, that's right, yeah. I didn't do that last time, yeah.
So that proves Underbelly takes place before Desperate Times.
There we go.
Kevin gets a little Easter egg in his ending as well. In every character, as they drive off, Kevin's the only one where you see a squad car going to the RPD, which everyone presumes is Leon and Claire.
Yeah, Leon, yeah. But
it's been proven false, though, because the number plates don't match up.
Sorry.
Proves everything.
It was actually Welsh who pointed that one out, I think, on PU.
Good lad.
There's no... There's no boss, but you funnel everything towards this final showdown, and you've got to just, you know, outlast all these zombies.
I like the fact that it's just a siege. Yeah. It's a zombie siege. It's the siege that gets Marvin his injury, basically.
And I think a lot of games now like have a siege mode, you know, like Gears of War and all that kind of thing, but this was probably one of the first to do it, I think.
That's a good call.
It's
actually
not quite the same, but it's you know, really early example of that gameplay style.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think the best thing about it is because obviously you see Marvin and what's happened to the RPD a bit more in RE3, but it's still pretty much the same as it is in RE2. But everything that you hear about in RE2 and RE3, you pretty much see in Desperate Times.
Well, I like how Ben's there. You can trade.
I like
evidence.
How Desperate Times explores the opposite wing of the RPD to that Jill goes in 3.
Yeah.
So across the two games, you actually do get the whole experience. So then when Biohazard 2 comes along, and you can actually explore it all with no restrictions, it feels right. It feels logical to do that with that game.
Was that certainly noticeable in your playthrough?
I've always thought about that, but it really hit home more this time, yeah.
If you play 3, then this, then 2, and obviously read all the files, everything comes together nicely, and you get like a clear picture in your head of exactly what's happened.
Yeah, I think, yeah. For me, it was the missing link just between 2 and 3, wasn't it? And, you know, as explaining everything goes on.
The only thing that it causes a problem with is that Jill is a bit of a heartless bitch just running past an unconscious Marvin. But then you argue that Nemesis was chasing her at the time. So.
I was going to say, I like how Ben's there collecting evidence, and you can trade him evidence that you find items. Yeah, it's a really good way to, you know, use the character and things like that, yeah.
Because it's actually the first time you get all of Irons' bribes listed by date as well.
And the surviving cops were actually collecting evidence against him as well, because you can collect film from their bodies, you know, like photo film, which apparently was evidence against Irons.
See, it's good. You know, Capcom can do it when they think about it.
It's a brilliant scenario. Like I said, without the nerve gas, it would be a contender for the best.
Mm. Okay, moving on to the final one, End of the Road.
Let me go!
No! It's way too dangerous to go back now.
I left something very important back there. Trust me when I say it's gonna be a big help to us later. I promise I'll be back before you know it.
Fine. But I'm not waiting long.
Fair enough. Thank you.
So long as you realize that it's my ass or yours, you can bet my ass will be the first out the door, baby.
Yeah, thank you.
Wait a second! She's human!
Carter.
This certainly felt like the conclusion of the entire Outbreak series, didn't it? Because it kind of brought home, you had a bit of Umbrella, it took you back to Jay's Bar, took you back to the Apple Inn, and then the kind of overpass, didn't it? And it was a big scenario again. Seems to take, look, maybe not as long as decisions, but it was certainly quite, I thought it was quite a long scenario. And it was nice to see Umbrella publicly in Raccoon City, because throughout all the games in Raccoon City, Umbrella's never been really that prominent, other than adverts and, you know, well, not probably adverts just around the city, that's all I can think of. But then here you've got the whacking, you know, the big headquarters, commercial headquarters, whatever you want to call them, right in the middle of the city, so everyone can see that's where they are. And I thought the environment was excellent.
Yeah, it's a nicely designed lab. Like, if we ever got the Umbrella Takedown game at, like, their main headquarters, I always imagined it would look something like that lab in End of the Road.
Yeah.
I really want to... I should look at those labs again, because, like, I work in labs now, and at least the Biohazard 2 labs is so unrealistic. I know people say, oh, you know, the retail RE2 police station is so unrealistic and 1.5 so much better, but the labs are so unrealistic. Because that's where I work, that's really jarring to me, more so than the police station.
You don't have a giant plant going up for it, no?
No. We don't have ladders. Do we have? No, I don't think we even got ladders.
But yeah, I mean, it certainly... I like the fact that it wasn't hidden. I thought that was quite good.
They've got hunters in their office lab. Well, you know, their city facade.
Yes, they have the Hunter Mew as well, which was a new one.
The little one.
The baby 125s, or at least I think they're supposed to be the baby ones, weren't they? And don't you have them in your labs, Gene?
No.
But it felt, as I said, I think it felt quite real, and that kind of led on to the you had the it wasn't Mr. X, and you have to forgive me, it was T00. TP, we like to think stands for Talos prototype, but there we go. TP00053, whatever it is, 104. And that was quite interesting because you got to use the MO discs, which are making a lovely return to the series. Everyone loves a good MO disc. And you got to use them to control the Tyrant, basically, to take out all the enemies. And I thought that was a lovely touch throughout during the game, just to say you didn't fear the Tyrant for the first time, but you knew it was going to turn.
Okay. I've reprogrammed it to take out those amphibian monstrosities instead.
Bodyguard, but oh well.
No need to worry. He knows who his masters are. That's not all. I packed in a special little present. So if worst comes to worst, tall, dark, and ugly is ground zombie meat. After all, weapons are only so good in as much as you use them.
Yeah, let's just get out of here, okay?
It's a great scenario. It has a bit of everything in it.
It's okay, but like you stand in the labs and you go this underground thing, and then you get on the streets. It's kind of like a roller coaster ride, sort of through these environments. Which
I think
it feels a bit disjointed. But the other side of that coin is, it feels like you're moving, like you're progressing through, and you're trying to escape, which the other scenarios don't really have.
Mm.
So I like that aspect, but the environment's not so great.
It's just a shame a lot of it is recycled, but then on the plus side, the fact that some of it is reused helps establish a real sense of geography in the city. You know, I like the fact that we can arrive at locations from different angles and go off them in different angles. You know, like we arrive in the outside the Apple Inn, but we leave it in a different way than we did in File 1. And it's really good for that point of view.
Mm.
But fuck the mines.
I was literally going to say that mine bit is absolute pain up the proverbial backside.
Yeah, I had to, when I did it on the series playthrough, I had to use an exploit where you have to release Linda and grab her again and use the animation to give you some invincibility from the bullet, because it hits you on every third bullet. What a bastard that section of the game is.
Very difficult. Very difficult. And then I thought Nyx was quite difficult as well, the actual...
The thing.
Which has been a bit of a debate about what it is.
It's Birkin, said a lot of people on the internet at the time.
I don't...
No, it's not.
It's not Birkin, but, there's so many G traits in it. And it would make sense, wouldn't it? I mean, if they just come out and said, oh, it's a G type. Escape from Birkin's lab.
I don't know. I don't think it's really like G at all.
No, I don't.
But then it makes sense for the USS trying to get it.
Well, we don't know, do we? That's obviously an untold story from one of the scrapped scenarios.
Yeah, it's a very icky monster. I like its ickiness.
It's quite similar to Ouroboros in many ways, because it absorbs, nearby organic matter.
Yeah, you can. It can absorb you and kill you in one hit if you get too close.
It's horrible if that happens and you've not saved.
That's why I actually think if you play these games, if they re-release them HD online today, I don't think anyone would have the patience to play Enter the Road and get to the final boss and die in one hit.
Yeah.
Because people would be so upset about that. I think they need a checkpoint system, but other than that, it was
if
a bit.
If you played
cruel
it multiplayer, though, couldn't you be rescued?
Not from one hit kills like that.
No, because aren't you just absorbed by it and you exist within it? And if the other players were able to kill it, you were released, weren't you?
No, I'm pretty sure you're dead once that one hits you. There's a few, like the elephant can trample you, and that like that kills you on the spot. But usually, if you get to danger, you get knocked to the floor, and then your virus gauge rockets up, and if that hits 100, you die. But so you can be in danger, and as long as they keep picking you up off the floor, you can actually just stay in danger for a really long time. But yeah, there's a few attacks, like I think Nick's, where yeah, you can't get out of it.
Mm.
The Neptunes in Decisions could knock you off the pier and just eat you. That was another one.
That was horrible.
Yeah, yeah. And again, that's right at the end of that really long scenario. You know, it's yeah. pretty.
I for the series playthrough, I kept the bomb switch in my inventory.
And you can use that on Nyx.
Yeah, blew up the Tyrant, and it causes Nyx to open his core, and I just grabbed the rocket launcher from the truck and just shot it. I actually one-shotted it. I was quite impressed.
That was smart.
That's good. But then, I mean, that Tyrant itself, I mean, certainly the Super Tyrant version of him looked awesome. And I think one of the better looking tyrants in terms of design.
It's the one from Death's Door.
I know, it's the one. It is the, I was about to say, I was about to go on to that point. I don't care.
I know people hate that idea, but I love how it connects. I really do.
It does connect. It just needs a little prod of the, you know, the tyrant got up. He, you know, he was knocked down at the bottom. He jumped up, came across Ada, jumped back down again. And then started crawling up after being very injured by Ada, and then got absorbed by Nyx.
That's just true. But look, we have bigger stretches. We have had bigger stretches with the timeline.
Of course we have.
You know.
Surely that's a better idea than just having a random tyrant turn up out of nowhere.
That was exactly. Don't even get me started on that. That was
a tyrant.
To be fair, they did drop
several
a load
miles
of tyrants
away, was it?
Didn't they drop a lot of tyrants into the city though?
Yeah, but all of them are accounted for, aren't they? One dies in Bio 2, sorry, and the rest die at the Paracelsus Sword facility. Yeah.
There's the one that escaped from Birkin's lab. That's the only one that's unaccounted for.
Maybe that's it.
Yeah, well, it's a lot of distance to travel.
Mm.
Yes, yes, yes.
And it just ends up miraculously in the same place that the Death Star Tyrant is.
Yeah, yeah.
Who's following his mate?
Yeah, and regardless of what you say, I mean, we are talking seconds before, you know, the other one turns up.
But he had enough time to get there, didn't he? That one from Birkin's lab. He had enough time to get there. I mean, when did he escape?
And he just hanged around for a few days.
Yeah. no, wait, right. What day did he escape? Did the tyrant escape from Birkin's lab?
I don't know. You see it in the tank on one of the pictures.
It's not there in below freezing point.
And then when you play the game, the tank's empty. So it escapes sometime before Resident Evil 2.
Okay,
or
so
below
well,
freezing
that's about...
point, isn't it? It's not there. What, it's not there for below freezing
what rough date? Could we put a rough date down on that?
Below freezing point, we say, is the
27th.
27th, yeah.
Okay, and when did Death's Door happen?
October 1st.
October 1st. And you said it was a long journey to take. It would have taken a few days. It would have gotten there. That's got the time frame.
Duran does nothing until miraculously a similar looking tyrant turns up. And then they both die within seconds of each other.
I know, and I think that's also that is also a point that we need to bear in mind. I know the argument's been said before. Look, there's hunters in Death's Door. They're hunter deltas or hunter alphas, whatever you want to call them, the model. But clearly, they're supposed to be the 1-2-1 beaters from RE3. They're not supposed to be the standard alpha ones, or even the 1-2-5 from the outbreak ones. But
why
I think
is this so difficult to believe? I mean, couldn't it be like a different part of the freeway?
But we know from Dark Side Chronicles and from RE2 how a traditional Mr. X mutates, right? This one has mutated exactly the same as Super Tyrant with, you know, the TP10004. I just think it's too much. I think it's too much of a push to say that this is, as Sean said, another tyrant that's come from Birkin's lab, that's come to exactly the same place.
And it was like a meeting point or something. But I mean, it's not a stretch, though, is it? Because it takes a few days. You say it's got a long journey ahead of it, right? Fair enough. It'll leave on the 27th or 28th, gets there by October 1st.
But why was
it time to be eaten by Nyx?
He maybe went for a beer with Carlos while he left Jill in the clock tower for 2 days before he decided to go to the hospital.
I'm... I'm in the church. I need to go somewhere and do something. There's a hospital next door. Do I need to go there? I don't know. But yeah, perhaps I should go there.
Well, I mean, it makes sense, because maybe it was just happened to turn up there, the one from Birkin's lab. Actually, no, because it was when Nix absorbs it, it was wounded, right? The one that's wounded is the one from the Outbreak File 2 scenario. Yeah, that's the one that was wounded and got absorbed by Nix. The one that Ada kills is probably the one that escaped from Birkin's lab.
Christ.
No, it's not. No,
it is.
It's not. Because
why would it sort of be the same one that gets absorbed by Nix?
No, it's not. It's before that. That's the whole point. You fight it in Outbreak 2 down on Main Street or whatever street it is, right? You injure it a bit. It then jumps up to the overpass, and then you fight it as Ada, right? And then it goes back, and then it kind of falls back down again, and then climbs back up, and then gets absorbed by Nix.
Yes. But why has it jumped down again? Or well, I don't know,
because that's the only way you can make it link.
Well, no, it makes sense. Why does everything have to fucking link? Can't it just be a type from Birkin's lab who was knocking about on the freeway at roughly the same time?
No.
You know that's ridiculous.
Because that's more far-fetched than that version.
Well, where's the one from Birkin's lab got to then? Now, where's he knocking about now? Because he was in the same... He hasn't been accounted for, is what I mean.
As Batman said, he's having a beer with Carlos.
Well, no, I mean, like,
I don't know.
Where's that gone then?
But my point is, if it was supposed to be a different one, they would have made it look different.
Yeah, come on. I mean, you can't honestly believe that the Umbrella Chronicles designers thought, hey, let's explain that unexplained plot thread from that photo in Biohazard 2, you know. Whereas...
Yeah, it's the same one. I mean, if you take the entire Death's Door scenario from Umbrella Chronicles, it basically is the final third of the end of the road scenario.
Yeah. Mm.
It literally, the whole thing is.
Just, Ada uses her hook shots to skip sections of it, doesn't she?
Yeah. And you even have the mines in that, don't you? Oh, no, it's Jill's raccoon destruction. You have the mines.
Yeah, you have the mines. Yeah.
And
then all that hard work in tying everything over is seemingly undone by the use of the angels, which I still don't understand to this day, but there we go.
Wait, what?
The bombers.
The bombers. The multiple bombings of Raccoon City. Again, you could argue that they did bunker bombs first with these people before sending in the one nuke. If you wanted to try and link it all up.
The sad thing is, it's a great sequence with the general.
Yeah, brilliant.
Well, that's the only conclusion you can come to, isn't it? If you want to include it.
It's kind of, yeah, but it's been debunked kind of. In many ways, since we got, you know, in subsequent film RE4 degeneration, if it all only ever showed, you know, one bomb going off, but I said, you know,
we did discuss this in File 1's one, but why was there the discrepancy?
I think I don't know. I mean, I don't think have we ever had proof that it was a genuine mistake.
I don't know, to be honest.
It's odd, isn't it? But there we go.
It's when you play the. That when you know you do the series playthrough and you go through it chronologically, it is one of the only things, in fairness to the series, it's one of the only things that actually stands out as being a legitimate mistake.
Yes. Yeah, I think you could be right about that.
Because everything else sort of flows and fits better than probably people give this series credit for, actually.
Well, I think, you know, the RE0 thing's a bit of a mistake as well, with the magic elevator and all that crap. You know.
Oh, I just treat that as a gameplay. I'm talking about the story point of view.
Right, okay, right. Yeah, it's very odd. Very odd, I don't think anyone... As you said, though, it's a great sequence to see a bit of the US government involved because they've been quite quiet. We never get to see the Tyrant factory, fight with the berets and whatnot.
Somewhere to the side of that scene in Outbreak File 2 is Derek Simmons and Ron Davis.
Exactly.
You know, weighing up what they've done.
I was going to say, it's a shame Simmons wasn't the general we see at the end.
That would have made
Am I right in thinking that Simmons is the person in Shuri's epilogue? Was that? I seem to remember reading that somewhere on a forum.
Leon's epilogue, wasn't it?
In Shuri's epilogue, where the army person goes to see her. Isn't Adam Benford the one in Leon's?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And Simmons is the one in... Cherries.
It's speculated, isn't it? I don't think.
Is it? I don't know if it's ever proved or not.
I don't think there's any proof, but I think it's speculated, and it fits at the end of the day, so...
It does. Why not? Why not? Okay. Moving on. Is there any... I mean, I suppose we're coming to the end, really. Does anyone have any other points they want to talk about? Any of the scenarios, any of the characters, anything else that you feel we've missed out?
There is more, Nick. There is more.
All the fun levels at the end.
The showdown and the elimination modes. Yeah.
Yes, yes, you're quite
right. Which I should tell you guys, they were by far the most popular to play online because they're really short.
Right.
And they give you tons of weapons and ammo at the start, and you just go and blast all the bosses and all the, you know, you go through the rooms and kill all the enemies.
It was the game's battle mode, wasn't it?
Yeah, but they were the most popular by far to play online.
Had a unique tyrant.
Yes, Tyrant C.
Tyrant C, yes, with the horns on its head.
And according to Newsbot, it's canon.
Really?
Like, he's the fucking expert on this, is he?
It's because it's Saturday. It's canon on a Saturday, not on a Sunday, you know. But, yeah, well, it's odd, isn't it?
Wait, so it's going to be classified as non-canon in about 10 minutes?
Probably, changing of...
So where does it fit within the series?
Oh, fuck.
It's already Sunday here, so what does that mean?
Fuck no. I mean, I don't know. I mean, there is an article on it on the PU website, at least there used to be. I think it probably falls in the same grey canon area as Survivor 2 generally, and the Tick from the Saturn version of RE1. Yep. I think it kind of falls into that.
But how can the Tick in the Saturn version
pass?
Because the remake has overwritten anything of the original.
Because it gets mentioned in an RE3 guide.
Oh my fucking god!
Which means that it's canon.
But it's referring to the original game, which has been overwritten by the remake. Surely
that doesn't stop. That doesn't stop us, doesn't it? I don't know. There we go. That's okay. If my recollection is correct, Bats can probably correct me on that.
What
about Tyrancy and Ticks? The canonicity of a Tick.
The Tick. As far as I'm aware, is only mentioned in the Sega Saturn guidebook. I don't think there's any information as to whether it's canon or not, but it's just one of those things, isn't it? If you want it to be canon, then
why not?
It doesn't do any harm.
But I don't see how it...
I just can't see it. I can't see it.
It doesn't really...
Well, no, because surely the remake overrides anything to do with the original, irrespective of what version the original came out on, even though Deadly Silence came out after the remake. It's the remake that goes into the canon, nothing to do with the original, surely.
Well, I treat it as that, but I also like to include stuff we know from the first game that isn't in the remake, for example. Like the scrapbook file that talks about all the murders, the newspaper articles, that gives us lots of dates for the timeline, but that file doesn't exist in the remake.
That's very true.
And George Trevor's note from Genesis.
Yeah, the anniversary note.
Yeah, anniversary note. That's quite a nice little, not in the remake, quite a nice little feature.
At the end of the day, though, it makes no difference, does it, if you have Ticks or you don't?
No. Anyway, we've deviated. We should utilise Selfish Gene's knowledge of Showdown and the online of it. How did it all generally work out? Multiplayer?
This will be interesting for people who say they want Outbreak and they want it online, and you know they want to play it again, because that, well, they used to do, like, you'd get like double or triple elimination points for, so your gallery points that you would unlock online you could spend,
okay,
for your single player, like, unlocks and things like that. And so they used to have like some weekends that give you double or triple points if you did Elimination 3 or if you did Flashback. Like, they'd try and promote scenarios like that.
Similar to how RE Net is supposed now, is it?
I don't use RE Net now. I've got no idea.
No,
I haven't played 6 in a long time. But yeah, so, and then another thing in Outbreak is if you, I think you get double or triple points if you don't use a weapon, and you get double or triple points if you don't take damage. So what would actually happen would be, like, in the scenario, the showdown and elimination, I think the first room is safe and there's heaps of weapons that you can pick up, load up, and then you go to the first boss. Is that right? No, eliminations was like that. I think showdown, you just start at the boss, but there's a lot of weapons. But people wouldn't pick up weapons and they'd just run to the corner to stay out of the boss's way, and hoping that one person would pick up a weapon and kill the boss, and then those three people would get 6 times as much points, like double for no damage, triple for no weapon, and then like triple for doing showdown 1, because that's what they're promoting, and just get like a billion points. So a lot of playtime was just waiting for someone to be the guy who picked up the weapon and started killing the bosses. Yeah, so people are kind of jerks, you know. It's not all happy, let's go do the scenario together. People actually, you know, really wanted what was in it for them. And another, I remember doing the giant leech in Showdown 1 and 3. And, well, you can lure the leech back to the dock and then just kick it to death. Mm. Like, you lure it to the landing and then everyone gets out of the water and you can just kick it and it can't hurt you. And so it would be the job of one person to go all the way up to the leech and goad it into attacking so it inches forward. And that would take like 10 minutes just to get it to the dock. And then everyone would kick it just to save ammo.
Oh.
Yeah, it's and you know, people, that's how people played. Like, yeah. It's weird. They didn't play properly, if there's any sense of that word.
No, I've had a similar experience. Have you ever heard of the Castlevania, multiplayer Castlevania game called Harmony of Despair?
No, I haven't.
They've created like a few levels, and you can pick Castlevania characters from previous editions, and you have a big overmap, and all the online is now is basically everybody using the best items and the best exploits, which include glitches to get to the boss to do it as quickly as possible. And that what you've just said there sounds similar to me. It's not about the experience of actually playing it. It's about using whatever glitches, exploits, using other players to your advantage to just basically get you the best score.
Yeah, absolutely.
Seems a shame that does.
I also had horrible latency playing all the way from Australia, from European servers. And I remember it was actually, for the most part, it was okay. So sometimes you'd shoot an enemy, and because the game's not very gory or violent, you're actually not sure if you've actually shot them. Like, if you shoot a zombie in the head with a shotgun in Resident Evil 2, it's very obvious that you've successfully shot it in the head. Whereas in Outbreak, there's no... I don't even know if it was censored or what, but you can't decapitate them. There's barely any blood. And so when I was playing online with this horrible latency, you'd actually spend a lot more ammo just to make sure things were dead. And the final form of Thanatos, where he jumps around, like he jumps kind of three times in quick succession, then lands next to someone and tries to attack them. Like that, with lag, that was just unplayable. Like he was just teleporting.
Oh, really?
And so, yeah, like he... I don't know what it was about that attack animation, but yeah, it just caused horrible, horrible bugs. And so you pretty much had to save the rocket launcher and just, you know, as soon as he appears next to you, just shoot him really quick. But apparently that was a problem for everyone. I don't know. I think it was in the coding or something of the actual game, and not just me, because of the lag.
Oh, well, there we go. Hmm. Okay. Is there anything else anyone wants to bring to the table before moving on to our favourite moments?
It doesn't really add much to the overall story, does it?
No. And I actually, for the record, I do prefer File 1 as a game.
Mm. It does feel a bit of a filler, I suppose. Maybe if we had Outbreak File 3, things might have been a bit more... You know, there's lots of missed stories, isn't there, and whatnot.
But I got the impression that they were kind of padding. Like, I think they were running out of stories by the time they got to File 2. Like, flashback... we could be okay if flashback never happened, you know?
Yes.
I don't think
it
adds very much. And I think the only scenario that would have a little bit of weight would be Desperate Times.
Mm.
But yeah, I think... And people say, you know, they planned 20 scenarios and they should have made 20 scenarios. And I think, well, the 10 that we did get, they were kind of stalling for time a little bit. I think it could have been a bit more focused.
Yeah, I think when we both played the series playthrough bats, I think we were both fairly pleased when Outbreak was actually over, weren't we?
We were, yeah.
They are hard work.
10 is enough.
Yeah, I mean, the other scenarios that was supposed to take place was, what, a day in Raccoon, wasn't it?
That's the only other one I think was nearly finished.
Yeah, I mean, I don't quite know what that would have made, you know, how different would that have been from the Apple Inn? You know, it's the same sort of thing, really, wasn't it? But it has just made it harder to pinpoint when all these took place. You know, it's hard enough at the moment, you know, I think, you know, trying to place wild things at times was a bit of an arse. So if we had another 5 to go, that goes there, that goes there. At the moment, it works quite well with the idea that teams split off and 4 of them get decisions, the other 4 get end of the road. That works quite well. That's how I always interpret it. If we had another...
Yeah, Outbreak's the loose cannon in the series. In that you could quite happily remove it from any timeline, and it wouldn't affect or be a detriment in any way whatsoever. We include it because it's, you know, it's fun to include it, but it's nearly impossible to sort of say this event happened on this date, and that's exactly how it's going down in the timeline. You know, it is a lot. Every scenario placement, bar arguably the ones we know are established.
Yeah,
it's still all fan theory at the end of the day. That's all it is.
And it's never been confirmed in any subsequent material, has it? That took place, you know.
No, because the daylight thing in Mahara Desire has been debunked, hasn't it?
No, don't say that.
Has it?
Wasn't it a translation fuck-up? I read somewhere.
No, I don't think it was.
Oh, good. Keep that one. I like that. Right, we'll move on to everyone's favourite moment, if they had any. George, did you have a favourite moment in Outbreak?
Fuck, yeah.
The music.
Well, because the music, yeah.
Same.
It's the same, yeah. I can't really. I haven't played the game enough to be qualified to give a favourite moment.
That's fine. Batman, did you have a favourite moment?
Not really a favourite moment, but I really enjoyed the end of the road scenario. I thought the background detail we got on Umbrella with their vaccine and the fact that you got to reprogram a tyrant, I thought all that was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
That'll do for me.
Yeah, Star Tyrant.
Actually being able to see Marvin Branagh alive and well, and you know, seeing a bit of his story before his end was the highlight for me. It was, you know, when they showed that, I remember the original Famitsu scans, which showed Marvin Branagh, and I'll never forget the giddy fanboy excitement I had at the fact that we're going to see this character realised. So it's still my favourite, the moments we get with Marvin.
Cool. Mr. Spencer?
I don't know, really. I mean, I'm very sort of indifferent about File 2. Like I said before, it's just more of the same, really, of the first game. So, favourite moments? I'd have to say, aside from the nerve gas canisters that really fucked it up, it was good to go back to the RPD again and get a little taste of what it was like before Leon and Claire got there. You know, people were still trying to escape, and you know, the RPD was still sort of existing at that point, even in a limited capacity. And but you know, the nerve, even my favorite moment is still undermined by this ridiculous nerve gas the game mechanic there. It's but yeah, there you go.
Fair dues. And Selfish Gene?
I think when you see Marvin limp back into the RPD after the holdout at the end of Desperate Times, and like the camera pans out and it fades to black and you got the music, that it's just really awesome because you know what comes next in RE2, and it's just, yeah, really effective, and that stuck with me for a long time.
Good. I like the fact that you could push the item box, but there we go. I just thought that was quite a nice look.
Yeah. Simple pleasures.
It was, because you know, obviously you knew item boxes weren't in the game at all, and they bothered to keep one in, albeit you couldn't open it. I thought that was quite good. So I don't think we've had any call-ins actually this week. I know there's been
the old haters.
Yeah, well, yes, there'll be rants about us. So never mind. So
it was just sort of like, yeah, where's this fucking Gaiden you promised?
Are you going to do a proper Gaiden podcast?
If there's demand for one,
It should be part of like an expanded universe podcast. It shouldn't have its own one, for fuck's sake. Seriously,
it could be wrapped up into a portable. So you could talk about Deadly Silence, I suppose.
Talk about GBC that got the ROM dump that came out.
Yeah, and George, you've got the game.com. RE2.
Oh yes, I have. Yeah, and I'm surprised how that it's never mentioned at all in it anywhere, is it? It's almost as if it doesn't exist.
You are a glutton for punishment, George.
Pardon?
You're a glutton for punishment. I've never played it personally, but I've seen a video on YouTube to know it must be horrible.
Yeah. I was going to say I've never played it. I mean, it looks quite poor. Just as an aside, I can't remember where I saw it, but I actually saw a legitimate Capcom advert for Resident Evil on the Game Boy, which
I've
I know was
got
dropped,
one.
But I didn't think it got to the stage where Capcom were actually advertising it with box art. The advert was the box art for the Game Boy Color RE1, and it was like coming soon in the fall, and actually had the box art and was a proper legitimate Capcom advert.
Was that the advert with three other games on it? And it's like,
yeah,
one
there were two. There were a couple of other games.
I've got that magazine. Have you got the magazine, or have you just seen the picture?
Oh, well, yeah, that's it. It's a scan. It's a scan from
yeah,
Ridley.
On the source of that image. So.
Ah, there we go. Yes, it's in Ridley's.
I've got the. I think the magazine's in my parents. Just let me look at my bookshelf.
Oh wow.
Yes, that yeah, source of adulation. That's all.
That, they were advertising it. They actually were, and it said yeah. coming really soon. But of course it never did. Yeah, no, I haven't got it, but it'll be at my parents' place. But yeah, everyone's seen the picture, I think.
Well, there you go. That could be something we could do, a kind of portable expanded universe for the Executor type podcast, perhaps in the future. Moving back onto this, everyone needs to give an Outbreak File to a score out of 10. Stars Tyrant, start with you.
7.
7. Good score, 7. Selfish Gene, bear in 7. Mind, you've played it more than most, I suppose.
Well, if you asked me in 2005, I'd say 9 or a 10. If you asked me to play it now, I'd say 2 or a 3. So.
To counterbalance it out and go, right.
Time hasn't treated it well, but I had a lot of fun with it. It was good. It was good. So, retrospective score of 8.
8.
Thanks. 8 or 9, yeah.
Mr. Spencer?
6.
6. Batman?
6.
And I just, George, just null and void.
Well, no, because, I mean, I've seen enough. I think 6 sounds about right okay. to me. I'll say 6.
Just 6. Okay, I think that does conclude our discussion on Resident Evil Outbreak 2. And without further ado, we'll now move on to this week's edition of Neptune and Newsies Biohazard Quiz.
Their minds will be tested.
I have an answer, but it's based on a thread that Welsh made.
Experiments will be undertaken.
I've been told by the boss that you have to be deducted a point.
Fuck off.
Great knowledge is needed.
I got massive 9 out of 5 last time.
And a new power will arise.
Jesus
what?
Christ!
What fucking question is that?
You said these questions weren't hard.
No, I
didn't. Then Vito might as well just have said, you know, what sandwich was I eating in 1985? Behind the lights.
George Trevor. The Batman. Stars Tyrant. It's time for Neptune and Newsies Biohazard Quiz!
Mr. Spencer.
Well, folks, welcome back. It's been a long time since the last quiz, hasn't it? It has indeed. So we move on to this week's edition. Selfish Gene hoping to do better than he did last time. Let's have a quick recap on everyone's scores. Ridley got 4, Wanderer 4, Rombie 4, Welsh Smiley, Archlon 3, Syndra 2.5, M. Greg, Zombie Fred, and I'm afraid Selfish Gene, you got 1 last time. So hopefully we can move you up the leaderboard a bit. Maybe get you up to 3 or 4s back in the elite group.
In the star and a reasonably priced That's, quiz.
Yes, exactly. God, I haven't used that for a long time. let's have a look at the current scores for our regular players. Joint third is Mr. Spencer and Ty on 17 points apiece. Second place, George Trevor on 19. Batman is on 24 points and leading. No, well, so there is a lifeline available, the Ask Newsbot lifeline, but as you can see, he's not here, so unfortunately, no one can ask Newsbot. Unless
can I just have a point? Can I just cash that in?
That's a good yeah. Cash that in. Excellent, excellent. So we have 5 questions for us, so if everyone can clear their desktop, you can open up Notepad, you know the rules. Let's move on with question number 1. This question is particularly difficult. It comes from Vito. He sends his regards.
Thank you, Vito, in advance.
Yeah, now they get their revenge for the Gaiden podcast.
Yeah, bastards.
I'll be honest, you might be surprised about this. I didn't know the answer.
So there we go. So what was the name of the guy mentioned in Jill's diary that Chris beat down because he dropped coffee on him?
Way! Thank you, Nick. You're beauty.
Oh, wow.
So on a second.
Can I say it now before anyone accuses me of cheating?
Go on.
No, I know it. I know it. I know you'll
Jill's
know it.
Jill's diary that you pick
in
up.
In RA3?
Isn't he the boys' crime department?
Boys' crime department. This
is true story.
Is this Jill's diary that you pick up from
people? His name's not different in the Japanese files, is it, Baz?
I can't recall, to be honest. But I know his name in the English. It's a stupid name, anyway.
Yeah,
is this Jill's diary from the one you pick up from picking up the files in the right order?
It's the person who splashed coffee on Chris's face. In the English file, it's different in the Japanese.
Chris belted him.
Typical bank reply there. Fucking lamped him, did he?
Right. Well, there you go. Question number two. Who was the chairman of directors at Raccoon Zoo?
Oh, bastard.
I should know this.
That's hard.
I know it. Can I say it now before anyone accuses me of cheating again?
No. What? Who accuses you of cheating?
Because every time I get these right, everyone just says, oh, you're a cheating bastard. You're looking at the timeline.
Can I
say it now so I can prove that I'm not cheating?
Well, no, because then everyone will get the point then.
Right.
You don't keep it quiet.
Good. Well done if you know that.
Mm. Question number three deals a lot with the discussions been going on in the forums regarding dominant plaga. So, what was the type 3 male plaga assimilation rate?
Type 3?
The type 3 plaga, male plaga, yeah. What was the type 3 plaga assimilation rate, male?
To males?
Yes.
You know, it's a naughty question.
Is it a bit naughty? Oh, very naughty, very naughty.
Very naughty.
Why is that funny?
I don't know. So we're looking for a percentage, by the way, chaps.
Of what?
Yeah. Well, the answer to question number three, it's a percentage. Last time you did a shot in the dark, George Trevor, you got it spot on with a number on the helicopter.
Yeah, I know. But
Quite incredible.
All this business about the plagas just does my head in.
Okay, question number four. I think you might get this one. Chris Redfield is the captain of what in Mahara Desire?
Captain? The team, he's the captain.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And finally, question number five. In preparation of next week's podcast, really, when did Curtis Miller die? Nice timeline question for you all there.
Well, you want the exact date?
I've got the exact date, yeah. I've got it. It's a known date, apparently.
Well, if it's from the chronology of evil, it's wrong. That's just a little error. The actual real date is on the production notes from the film.
Well, we'll see what you get. We'll see what I got. And I'll be well,
which source have you gone with, Nick?
It's just on ports. It came up as a random file on the on random articles on the PU website. So it could be right. We'll find out. Batman sounds confident he knows the answer. So join us after this when we'll run through the answers.
Huh? What? Oh yeah, you were just asking what I was up to, right? Getting ready to start work again. Hold up. Now that's what I'm talking about. The ones with the red stripe over on the right side of the third shelf. Huh? Oh, sorry, I was just talking.
Welcome back to Neptune and Newsy's Biohazard Quiz. Let's see how everyone has done. So question number one came in from Vito. He thought it was difficult. At least two people seem to know the answer. What was the name of the guy mentioned in Jill's diary that Chris beat down because he dropped coffee on him?
Can I go first?
Yes. Go on.
Well, I had the privilege of reading Jill's diary to the Biohazard 3 voice actress, Catherine Disher.
You did.
I did, yeah. I'm trying to persuade her to read it out in character, which is proving a lot more problematic than you would expect, through no fault of her own at all, just to do with the law in Canada. Elran,
okay. Mr. Spencer?
I knew it was sort of beginning with E, but I wasn't sure what, so I went Earl.
Earl, okay. And Selfish Gene.
I put Percy. I've got no idea. just a guess from
that seems like a bit of a paedophile name, doesn't it? Almost. It's like an old man called Percy, and he's got glasses on, and he runs the boy crime department.
Only people of my age will appreciate this, but I think it's so depressing that Jimmy Savile, because my son's now old enough, and in his school, all his mates, Jimmy Savile is now just basically a synonym for paedophile. It's just slang now. They all say, "Oh, you Jim." They call each other, "Oh, you Jimmy Savile." It's so sad.
Right.
Why?
I'm probably more sad for his victims. Sorry.
Yeah. Right.
He groomed a nation. He's a monster, basically.
Batman, what did you put for the answer to this one?
Elrond.
Well, did you say that again, sorry?
I called him a cheat, but I was just...
Sorry, Batman, I missed what you said.
I said Elrond.
And what did you put, Ty?
Elrond.
That is the correct answer. So, points there for Batman... GT and Stars Tyrant.
What is the name of the department, Bats, out of interest?
I don't know, but it's not going to be called Boys Crime Department.
I'm going to look it up.
It's called the Juvenile Crime Department or something.
Yeah. It might be like the Rookie Division or something.
I'll have a look. Hang on.
But there we go. Yes, the answer was Elrond. Very good, very good. So, question number two was, who was the chairman of directors at Raccoon Zoo? We'll come back to Selfish Gene. Oh, I've got his answers. Okay. Selfish Gene just currently departed. So, what did you put, Mr. Spencer? What did you put as the director of... chairman of directors?
Well, I know. I looked at what Gene put, and I could tell you Austin was actually a guy who was actually in the building. He was a survivor, but he was not the chairman. The chairman, I think... I don't know. I'm getting the name.
Are you?
Elliot Harmon.
Who?
Harry Harmon. Elliot Harmon. I don't know why I'm getting Elliot in there, but there's an Elliot coming in. It's just, I'm getting the name Elliot.
Right. Okay.
Did you hear Nick recall in horror when he thought you mentioned the name of a Labour politician?
yeah, that's true.
Sex bitch.
Right, let's just have a look.
Labour.
Selfish Gene has quickly departed. He's put Austin. George Trevor, what did you put?
I'm tied between Terry Nupkins and. No idea.
I was holding back the laughs there, but
I couldn't help it. I'm sorry for laughing at you. I couldn't help it. Terry fucking Nupkins.
Is he even still with us anymore?
He died a couple of years ago, but
he died a bit too early a few years ago, yeah.
Oh. Stars Tyrant, what did you put?
I honestly don't know.
Batman?
John was close. It's Elliot Martin.
Oh, I knew it.
Correct. It's points. It is points there to Batman. It's Elliot Martin. Very good.
But I said Elliot.
Yes. I'll give you half point. Don't worry. For half. Half a point.
I've got to squeeze every point here.
Sorry, Austin was not correct, Selfish Gene. It was Elliot Martin.
Sorry, yeah, I just picked one of the NPCs who you can find.
That's fine.
Yeah, no idea.
Okay, moving on to question number three was, what was the male plaga assimilation rate? Gene, what did you put?
98%.
98%. Batman, what did you put?
It's probably 90-something, isn't it? 94%.
94%. George Trevor?
I mean, I'll guess, but the scope of my knowledge isn't even that I would even... Like, John is obviously aware it's in the 90s. I wouldn't even know that or why it needs to be in the 90s. 95%.
Mr. Spencer?
I said 90%.
And Star Starrant?
I'm pretty... 90%, I think.
92%.
So who was closest?
No one.
Well, not bad, is it?
What?
Yeah, me and Sean.
22% off? Fucking hell.
That was only 2%.
Well, so was Batman. No, I think you have to be...
Yeah, you've got to get it right, yeah.
If anyone was one out, I might have been generous. I mean, question number four, so no points there for anyone. Question number four was, Chris Redfield is the captain of what in Mahara Desire, i.e. I'm looking for the name of his team. George Trevor?
I'm a little bit confused because the answer that I would give is a bit straightforward because as far as I'm aware, it just refers to him. He's the BSSA... North American branch, which we knew anyway, and he's out for two years. I think it just says out. It says Chris because there's a little box. It says Chris Redfield, BSA North America, Alpha Team. Okay. I can't think of anything specific to Mara Desire.
Okay. George, I don't know if you've done it. Batman?
Yeah, I think the same. Alpha Team. Special Operations Unit, Alpha Team.
Okay. Mr. Spencer?
What was the question again?
That's normally what I do.
Chris, oh, SOU, I put, I don't know, I don't fucking care about that.
What? Stars so Tyrant.
I was just going to go with what Biohazard 6 does because I didn't know any different, to be honest, and say Alpha Team of the BSAA North because he's not ever affiliated to any other division.
And Selfish Gene.
I thought surely they're not going to use Alpha Bravo again, so I put Blue Team, and I just, there was a guess, I don't even know where from. But
they use Alpha and 6.
Yeah, I haven't played 6 since it came out.
Oh, right, okay, sorry.
Points.
I loaned it to a friend and I don't really want it back.
Points to Mr. Spencer for Special Operations Unit. That's the answer I was looking for.
Oh. Holy fuck, that was a guess.
So congratulations to Mr. Spencer.
It says, so there's somewhere in Mara Desire it says Special Operations Unit.
Apparently so.
John, should we...
Hang on, I said Special Operations Unit as well.
You did actually, John.
Did you?
Yeah, he did.
Just said Alpha.
Yeah, but then he Precious said... Unit Alpha Team.
Oh, okay, fine. Points there.
But that's not the name of his squad. The name of his squad is Alpha Team.
Can we? I know there's Ask News, but can there be flag the founder? Can I flag up the founder to check the accuracy of that answer?
Flag.
Because he's a special operations agent in Biohazard 5, but when you're in the team, it's Special Operations Unit.
Does it say that anywhere in Mahoy Desire? Because when I flicked through it earlier to give my answer, I couldn't see it anywhere.
So what we're saying the answer is Alpha Team, so I can get the point as well. And come on.
Yeah, the answer should be Alpha Team.
Yeah.
Come on, Nick. Come on.
Oh, piss off. I was given a point here for what I did.
Fine, you can all have points. Fine, whatever.
Oh, no, because George said... No, Gene said Blue Team.
Yeah.
And George, what did you say?
I said Alpha Team. I said BSAA North America Division Alpha Team.
I said Alpha Team.
Oh, okay, we all get points then.
Right, okay. And
so, I don't think there's any reference in Maha Desire to the Special Operations thing.
Well, then you need to amend the Project Umbrella page on it.
It says it on the patch on his shoulder, SOU.
That's what I looked at. And because of that, I'm going to give Selfish Gene.
Doesn't Piers' uniform say that, and 6 as well?
Yeah, because they're all part of the... I saw
you
out.
Yeah.
There you go. And finally, question number 5 is, when did Curtis Miller die? Batman, we might have to flag the founder again, but I've got a date. Stars Tyrant, what did you put?
Well, this is interesting because it's all been thrown in the air with what Bat said. I know on the... Because when I was typing up the series playthrough, I always referred to the Catalyst because that's you know, the most modern timeline it had. When I checked out Degeneration's date, it was August 15th. Bats has now said it's wrong, so that left me very conflicted when I was writing my answer. And so I don't really know what to say. I know a lot of the issues in the Resident Evil timeline are if something crosses the threshold of midnight, like the October 1st, October 2nd thing for Raccoon being destroyed. So with that in mind... I'm going to go out on a limb and I'm going to say August 15th, 2005, because I'm going to say it goes over the midnight threshold. Okay. I'm going to go for it.
Okay, okay. I've got that logged. Mr. Spencer, what did you put?
I put November 2005.
George Trevor?
I've got no idea.
Selfish Gene?
I put August 15th, 2005, but But don't read into that because I thought it's 2005, it's in summer, August, and then 15. I have no idea where I got that. That is a guess. Yep. all my answers today were guesses. Yeah. All my answers today were guesses.
Batman?
Because it's after midnight, I put November 13th, 2005. Because the reason I got that is if you look at the Ron Davis's computer where it's deleting all the files at the end, it basically, you see a load of text documents and it basically reads off the events of the film and it says something like, Senator Davis arrives at the airport for a pharmaceutical conference which takes place in 2 days' time. And then I think in Angela's diary, there's an entry on November 7th where she says the pharmaceutical conference takes place in a week's time. Which
the
means
Catalyst has it as August, doesn't it?
No, it's November.
Why the fuck? I fucking typed August and
I thought it happened in summer.
No, it's November. Angela's diary happens in August, and her last entry says something like, there's a pharmaceutical conference in a week's time, which would be November 14th. The film takes place 2 days prior to that, which is the 12th, but obviously it goes after midnight, so it's the 13th.
Wow.
I need to go check back through my series playthrough thread.
Yes, it is November. That's correct, November 2005.
Oh, fucking hell. Biohazard Degeneration, this is my series playthrough. November 14th. So where the hell am I thinking? That's completely wrong, isn't it? Right month.
I've got it as November 14th. 3 o'clock.
Where the fuck did I get August from tonight?
I don't know.
3 o'clock?
Well, that's when he leaked the virus at Harvardville.
Is that in the morning?
Yeah, but you asked when Curtis Miller died.
I know, but I've got November 14th.
No, what was the question? Was it when Curtis Miller died?
Yes, I've got...
Right.
November 14th.
November 12th, then, because it's before midnight.
I've got November 14th.
That's the day of the conference.
November 14th is in the chronology, then, isn't it?
Well, I've got it...
Because that's where I'd have got the date from. Let me just check.
I've got it as November 14th.
See, on the production notes, it says Senator Davis arrives at Harvardville Airport for a pharmaceutical conference which takes place in 2 days' time.
Right.
And Angela's diary has an entry on November 7th saying that there's going to be a pharmaceutical conference in a week's time, which would make it the 14th of November. It's something like that. I can't remember.
Yeah, November 14th exactly. Is what's in the chronology.
So, Batman, you don't get a point then?
Oh, fucking hell. it says on the production notes.
Well, you know, take it up with Newsbot. He's got it as the 14th. You can get half. You can get half for November.
Newsbot's wrong on this account.
Is it? Well,
so what date are you saying it's supposed to be, Bats?
November 12th.
Right.
It says on the production notes that when Senator Davis arrives at the airport for the events of the film, the conference will take place in 2 days' time. But Angela's diary has an entry in November 7th, which says it'll take place in a week's time, which means it would be on November 14th, the day of the conference. So the events of the film take place 2 days prior to that.
So Ron Davis's note is set in is 2 days prior, yeah. So what? Just run that by me again. What does he say, Ron Davis?
He doesn't say... The production notes on the computer say he arrives at the airport...
2 days before, yeah.
For the fans.
Oh, yeah, I'm with you. Yeah, oh, yeah, then that's it.
Yeah. 2 days' time.
That's right, then. Yeah.
Unless he's talking about work. Unless he's talking about a working week.
No, I'm with Bats on this one. Resident Evil doesn't take into account weekends, does it?
No. Okay, I'm overruled. Points for Batman. There. Half a point.
Yeah, fair play. That's good. Yeah. Good research.
Half a point for Mr. Spencer for getting November. Very good. Yeah. And so that concludes the quiz. So let's have a look, see how everyone's done. Batman with a commanding lead. He got 4 out of 5. Very good, very good. In second place appears to be Mr. Spencer with... I just say, because second place I think has been joined by everyone else. George Trevor, Mr. Spencer and Ty all got 2 points apiece. And
I only got one, Nick.
I've got you down as 2, Sean.
No, I only got Elrond right this week.
No, you got the point for BSAA.
Oh, right, okay.
Alpha team, yeah, he's fine, yeah, he's fine. And Selfish Gene matches his
0.
Loss. No, you got 1 for blue team.
Why?
Well, because because I was feeling generous because everyone overruled me on BSA agent. There we go, so let's see what's that done to the leaderboard. That has given a commanding lead to Batman. Now on to a staggering 28 points. George Trevor.
Can I just ask, I hope you are putting into place now conspiring some kind of mechanic for the very last podcast to make sure that commanding lead disappears just like it did last time.
I wouldn't dream of doing something like that again after the controversy it caused.
I should actually let you know that my official prize for that has sold on my website shop.
You're joking.
I sold it, yeah.
Bastard, that's your prize.
Yeah. Well, the sweatband. Yeah, I sold it.
Oh, thanks. There we go. George Trevor, you are second with 21 points. Mr. Spencer and Ty, you have moved on to 19 points. And Selfish Gene, you join. Well, you stay where you are, really, on 1 point. So I can't promote you any higher, I'm afraid. You're still under Syndra, which is not a bad place to be. So there we go. That concludes this week's quiz. Join us next time when we'll have some more questions.
Anyway, that concludes our podcast generally. We can now look forward. We are coming to an end, really, of our podcast. There's not many topics left to discuss. Next podcast, we're going to be doing Degeneration.
Gaiden.
We are going to be doing a Degeneration podcast next. That should be in the next 4 weeks-ish. And then we're going to do a final 2013 Christmas special, looking back over the year, maybe a look forward to next year. And also what we're going to do, we're going to put a thread after we've done the Degeneration podcast. We're just going to put a thread on the forums, and then people can ask us, not questions, but things that we can discuss, and we can go through them. Because it's actually been quite a bit of a barren year for Resident Evil 2013 generally, isn't it? So there's not a lot to look back on. So
what about Silent Hill and The Last of Us and other games like that?
That may be going ahead, but certainly not with my involvement.
I think we should all... I've just had a message. I think we should all take this opportunity to wish a legendary Project Umbrella staff member, Chimera, a happy birthday, because it's his birthday today.
Happy birthday, Chimera. We'll try and get him on at some point on this podcast.
We do need to get him on, even if it's just once.
Yeah. And on that note, then, I will bid you all farewell. It is goodbye from me, Neptune.
Goodbye from me, Batman.
Goodbye from me, Stars Tyrant.
Goodbye from me, Jane.
It's goodbye from me, Mr. Spencer.
Goodbye from me, George Trevor, and I am truly sorry. It was all down to Nick.
Time to start something new, you know? You really should come by.